Freddie was actually approached when we were in New York. So this must have been 81, 80, by Joseph Papp, who had done a production of The Pirates of Penzance in Central Park. Big open air, thousands and thousands in the audience. He was putting on a new production of La Bohème before Baz Luhrmann came up with his sort of interpretation of it. And he asked Freddie if he would audition for the role of Rodolfo. Elizabeth McGovern was going to be the Mimi. It was turned down on 2 points. One, he asks me to audition. And then he also turned around and said, well, there's no way on earth I'm going to do 8 shows a week for 2 weeks. I mean, those days, they're gone. So, I mean, he'd been thought of for different things. It's just he, I think, maybe was a little bit insecure outside of the bubble that he knew. Queen was his musical bubble. And to do little things outside needed a lot from him.
Ingrid, my wife, and my 3 sons, Julian, Felix, and John Frederick, always had the pleasure to stay at the Kensington home, Freddie Mercury, Garden Lodge number 1. He would love, I'll make sausages for you. And then it was, Phoebe, make sausages. Or I remember coming down with Julian from Scotland. We were looking at a band, and Julian, do you like some champagne? You know, I'll get you champagne. Phoebe, get champagne. You know, and he liked that being together with young, opinionated people. You know, because children are, you know, say, like Felix would say, is this? Why are there only men in the house? And Ingrid is like the only female. And it was just like, yeah, because they like each other, you know. And children don't think of the some weird sexual practices. They just think, yeah, sure, you know, my friends come over to my birthday, and that's all little guys. So they're not necessarily gay, are they?
I don't think anybody could ever sum up Freddie. He was, you know, people talk a lot about his uniqueness, a one-off. He was so many things wrapped up in one crazy, talented body. But if my everlasting memory of him was his genius coupled with his kindness. He was the kindest, most thoughtful, funniest rock star I'd ever known. He loved Japanese art. I think everybody knew that. In fact, everywhere I went with him, the first place we would go was to either antique dealers or galleries. And there was one time in Tokyo, we were literally running up and down aisles, grabbing things off stands. And he was on one side of a fitting, and I was on the other side, and there was a teapot, and I grabbed the handle and he grabbed the spout, and I won. So I took this, I'd had this teapot for years, and then when I knew he was ill, I sent it to him with a note, and that was kind of the last I heard from him.
I think there was a level of musicianship in that band that where everyone was kind of very competitive with each other about writing, trying to write the next great thing. And in many ways, they all did. You know, I mean, they all wrote the next great thing. But Freddie's piano playing, I think, was particularly stylistic. And you get a hint of it, like on the front of Death on Two Legs, where, you know, you felt like he kind of would wander into the sort of classical world a little bit. And, you know, we knew he was interested in ballet and the emotional impact that can have. I think more than anything, as a singer, I mean, he was a great piano player, and especially a great piano player for that band. But as a singer, it's an extraordinary sound that guy made. And it's only when you hear other people covering those songs, you know, as brilliant as they were at the Wembley gig, you know, the memorial show, you kind of realised how much difference he made to those records, you know, because the vocals were extraordinary. Not only he could be extraordinarily tender, but he could like scream and shout and push these kind of sort of rock tunes out, as well as doing like Love of My Life or something. You know, it was an extraordinary range, and you always felt like he was absolutely honestly telling the truth. You know, no matter how ridiculous the whole thing was, he'd always sell you the idea of this song as a performer, as a musician, that it was okay to like it. So I think more than anything, I think he's just an amazing singer. One of the things I liked about John Barry was that whenever he wrote something for a Bond movie, if it was a song, then it would appear to have nothing to do with anything that was going on around it at the same time. You know, when he wrote Diamonds Are Forever, you know, Sgt. Pepper had come out. There seemed to be no correlation between the world that he created and the outside world, other than he became a part of it. And I think to a certain extent, with Freddie, it was like he kind of created this universe. He created this umbrella, which was like Queen music. And underneath that, you could pretty much do anything you wanted.
I think Queen was like a marriage. And I know I've been through a few. But this was four people. I mean, normally a marriage is just two. So two people, of course there's, you know, differences of opinion and all this. Can you imagine four people? And I used to call them North, South, East and West. And there was North, who was Freddie, totally that way with opera. And there was East, the heavy metal, Brian, Chuck. And South would be Roger, also laying down the law. And but I should say South should be Dickie, really, laying down the law, really, with his, yeah. Anyway, North, South, East, and West. Let's not decide who's North, South, East, and West. But the point being that there was this pulling this way of musical styles. Or maybe one could say coming in this way, which would be better. And it caused this incredible, not friction, but explosion, I suppose, or implosion, musically, where you'd have this amazing groove going on, plus opera, plus heavy metal, plus harmonies and musicality. These guys were very intelligent. They still are. Miss Freddie.